Congratulations.
I hate it, and it's going to be a terrible burden.
I do. It's horrible. Yeah.
Jesus.
You're on the telly. Come here.
I think I was feeling like I was just the longer I waited with another day of no work, another day of nothing to go to, the more I was just getting stagnant. It's a bit like sort of after an operation where you want to rest, but you've got to push it. And I just had to push something.
She can't be found.
The only way I knew how to do it was just get back on the boards again with anything. So I'd hit upon the idea.
I don't belong. My heart isn't strong. Don't be long.
The next time around, she'll be here.
Just
cartoon most people call animation.
But it's very un-Disney-like, isn't it?
Well, I love Disney, and it's influenced by Disney, but the fellow who did it said, oh, that's all been done. But I love the idea of entertainment, you know, and animation's something I loved when I was a kid.
Linda, when you're working on a film, do you consult Paul at all? Do you ask him his advice?
Constantly.
No, never, Rex.
No, I just showed it to him when it was finished, and he said, oh, I don't like it. Not true, but...
Well, are you at all competitive in your marriage?
No, not really at all, no.
I have no ambitions, you see, so he's all right.
Paul, you're, what, 38 now?
37.
Right. Well...
I'm 38.
Are you?
Yeah.
Paul, you're obviously very successful. When Elvis Presley was 40, he was fat, drunk, and dying. You obviously are the picture of health and fairly well-adjusted. How do you do it? What's your secret? Is there anything that the world should know about?
Well, you know, I mean, I suppose, like, before I married Linda, I was about to burn myself out. But I didn't realize it at the time, you know. But looking back now, kind of 11 years later, there were definitely a few moments there where I was getting near the edge kind of thing. But Linda's kind of a steadying influence.
That's because she's American, I think.
She's American.
Now, was this 11 years ago? You've been married 11 years?
Yes.
Would you believe it?
11 years.
I wouldn't.
And four children later.
Did anyone say it wouldn't last?
I suppose.
Yeah, Elizabeth Taylor. She swore it wouldn't, but I said, Liz, this is going
to
run.
And look what she's been up to for the last 11 years.
Oh, no.
She should be so lucky. I know, Paul, that you're very tired of Beatles questions, but even if we never have this long-anticipated and eagerly awaited reunion that the whole world hopes for with the Beatles, do you think that there would ever be a chance of another Lennon-McCartney song, maybe just one song from you guys?
Well, I wouldn't say there would be, actually, because the last time I spoke to John, I just happened to ask him about whether he was writing songs and stuff, just out of my own curiosity. And he's told me he's kind of finished doing that, and he's not really into that. But which, when you say it to people, they say, oh, well, you know, this big disappointment, or you must have gone crazy or something. But if you think about it, like, I mean, most of us do our jobs to arrive at a point where we no longer have to do our jobs, where we put our feet up and we can enjoy life for a change. And I think he's probably reached that point.
Well, you haven't reached that point, so the work must
you
still be...
You can't enjoy life, huh?
The work must still be important, though, to you.
Well, I just like it, you know. It just is, it's sort of like a hobby to me. I just enjoy doing it, you know. It's a relief for me to write a song. If it ever got to be a pressure, I'd stop it.
Is it true that you are the richest rock star in the world
since Croesus? I don't know, man. I mean, I don't know how rich everyone else is. You know, I'm not counting.
You
Who's counting, Rex?
First of all, you actually started on recording a new album.
Yeah.
And you've been going, what, for 4 days or something?
Yeah. Yeah, we're in the back room of, if you went through there, that's the studio we've been in. And yeah, we just put down some backing tracks for a new album. The way I do it is I think of it in my mind and think of this kind of way I'd like it to be and then tell everyone that. And then we kind of do this thing of kicking it around a bit, and some little things will start to suggest themselves because of a style someone else is playing that I wouldn't have thought of.
Yeah.
And that sort of gets included, you know, all the good ideas we keep. And we'll change a thing in the course of recording it from my original idea, but hopefully for the better, you know, something I just didn't think of.
And what about you as a solo effort, again?
I've done a few songs, actually.
Yeah.
But I don't quite know what I'll do with them yet.
Yeah.
Release them?
I might release them in 1893.
Now, there is a surprise artist called Susie with a group, the Red Stripes, Susie and the Red Stripes. It sounds remarkably like Linda.
Are you having me on?
And No. Really. But, I mean, if Linda does any stuff, we kind of thought that she doesn't really want to release it under her own name, because then people sort of say, oh, you know, look, she's getting flash, you know, look what she's really trying to do. But she's had a bunch of songs, so she's going to release some of them under a name which will be very like Susie and the Red Stripes. But it's not her, is it, folks?
In fact, there's a song called Seaside Woman you might hear sometime.
Yeah.
So if you ever hear it by Susie and the Red Stripes, I can say I told you so.
Well, since you've been last down, Speed of Sound has been a monster. Now the double album, Wings Over America. You must have been really happy about the live sound that came out of that album?
No, we hated it.
You hated it?
I terrible. Loved it, he hated it.
I see. Well, what didn't you like about it then?
No, I'm only kidding you, Ian.
I see.
I kid you not. I liked it, actually. It was all right.
Yeah. And you've just seen the main rushes of the film, or the film sort of itself.
Yeah.
And when do you think that could be sort of out on the world market?
Next Friday, I think. If we hurry it a bit, could be. Failing that, Christmas. Yeah.
Any chance of coming down to the Land of Oz again?
Yeah, we're thinking
definitely.
About it, you know. What we're doing this year, though, is we're kind of taking it a little bit easier because we're pregnant.
Yeah.
I'm pregnant too, you know, and I've got to take it easy. But so we're going to mainly get into songs and stuff this year and kind of change the act around and stuff that we'd be playing. So by the time we come back to Australia, we should have a whole new thing, you know. And so we're going to mainly record this year, but we might see you there in 1978.
Right.
The whole country is fabulous. The animals, the koala bears.
Well, I know.
In fact, we're thinking of trying to get them back in the Commonwealth.
What, Australia? Well, listen, I know I can say for thousands of Australians, we do look forward to the new album because, I mean, like, it tops down in our country.
Great. And hello, well, Norman really. Gunston.
And goodbye, Ian Melton.
All right. We're getting very close to the end. Ladies and gentlemen, Paul McCartney! Chrissy said to me, she said, you know, will you sing a song or two? I said, well, I don't know if I'll be able to, but I've got a little bit of time. Okay. So where's my band? Come on, guys, the Pretenders. Yo.
Okay.
Okay, get them off. I just want to dedicate all of this to Linda, who's my beautiful baby, and our beautiful children who are here tonight. It's past your bedtime. And some other beautiful children who are here tonight, including my new grandson, 1 week old.
He's him.
Yo. Yo, Arthur. This is a song which Linda and I used to listen to. I was in Liverpool, she was in New York, but we both listened to it in the 50s. It's by Ricky Nelson. It goes like this. Town, where the broken heart.
Thank you.